Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lure, Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Today, Wednesday, October 9, 2024, the North Carolina General Assembly is about to start their session to possibly vote on a bill that would fund Hurricane Helene relief efforts. Please subscribe and support my work at anniedance.substack.com. Simply type your email in and click subscribe, and you have the option to become a paid subscriber, which gives you even more access to scoops, exclusives, and other content. Thank you for your support as I work to shine a light on these important issues.
Understand have been fixed at this point. So the chair will start the committee just by simply saying you all seen the extreme damage in Western North Carolina and was in where I live and also further west and got a chance to go see that damage. And it is just unbelievable what the western part of our state's facing right now. And so the chair wants to thank all the staff members who have worked diligently for the last several days to put this bill together. Scope of the need is really not even known yet, but of course, this body wants to do what it can right now to try to meet at least some initial needs. And Chair also wants to thank the individual members who have been out to Western North Carolina and those who live there because uniformly you've seen those members out in the communities volunteering themselves, trying to help their folks. And so, Chair, I don't want to keep folks too long here today because many of these members are going back to Western North Carolina tonight. And so we want to get them out of here before it gets too late. So with that said, we'll go ahead and begin. Chair will ask the bill sponsors to come on up. Just one second. Okay, so we're on House Bill 149, Conference Committee Substitute, Representative Balcom, the lady is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate everyone today. So this is just the beginning. This is the beginning. This bill is pretty much an immediate response to set up the necessary infrastructure for effective and long-term recovery efforts for Western North Carolina. It provides state agencies with flexibility they need to help restore normalcy in hard-hit areas while addressing both immediate and future needs. We have worked hand in hand with state agencies to compose this legislation. We want to ensure it meets the immediate challenges right now we are facing while laying groundwork for future resilience and recovery in the future. Mr. Chair, I'm not going to go through all the details. If someone has a question, what I may do is refer to staff on some of that as well. But setting this up and getting this started is what Western North Carolina needs right now, and I turn it over to you.
Representative Green, does the gentleman wish to be recognized now or later? Gentleman will be recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'd like to echo what my colleague has said about this bill. We know this is not the end, but maybe it is the beginning of our part of the state. There was no corner of my district that wasn't at least impacted, if not devastated, by this particular event. And it's a long road that we face, but hopefully this effort will begin to stop the bleeding and let the healing start. And it's going to be a long road to recovery, but there are a number of things in this bill that are going to provide the framework for the work to come. And we appreciate leadership and the staff. And while I'm here, I try to not to overlook an opportunity to thank the entire state, as well as the entire Southeast and really the country for the unprecedented response that there has been in volunteerism and relief efforts, and we just hope it will continue. And thank you for these efforts to begin the recovery. So
thank you, Representative
hopefully
Green.
it can be the beginning of many good things to come.
Amen. And thank you both. And as you know, everybody in this body is with both of you. You both suffered loss in your district and personal loss as well. And so we're with you in the state and country as well. And thank you for what you're doing back home. Representative Dahl, I believe the lady wanted to be recognized.
I needed to ask a question.
Lady's recognized.
Okay. In the old document that was 45 minutes ago, on page 3, starting at line 31, there was a technical assistance grant restricted to local governments of $250,000 or less. And I wanted, it looks like you took it out, but I wanted to ask why that might be in there.
And Chair understands we've got staff on hand today to answer questions, and judging by the look on their face, I think they may want some clarification on the question, but Mr. Edified, gentleman, wants to answer that if you can, or seek clarification if you need to.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So that section remains in the bill. You're talking about page 3, section 6.1A3, starting with $2 million for?
No, it's, well, it's technical assistant grants, and they're restricting them to local government with a population of less than 250,000.
Representative Baucom, ladies recognized.
Sorry, thank you. So I do remember them saying that part of this is to make sure that our smaller towns that were hit very hard, and I'll give an example of Chimney Rock, Back Cave. I don't even know if y'all have heard of Back Cave. We want to make sure that those funds are being used for the smaller towns first before. So I know that they had put some of that in there for that particular reason to make sure small towns were covered. If I'm incorrect, please. Nope, he says I'm on point. Thank you.
Follow up.
Representative Dahl, ladies recognized.
I want everybody to get the help. Please don't understand. I'm just asking clarifying questions. Everybody up there was hit.
Yes, ma'am.
So are there, because, you know, I know Back Cave doesn't have the same infrastructure as Asheville and all that other stuff, but are there other grants that you either see coming out or other resources for larger towns to go to, because they were just so I'm just asking for clarification.
The members, while they're discussing, well, Representative Baucom,
sorry, I do have it. You just have to let me find the details. But if you look, it is just prioritizing the grants to those counties first. That does not mean a bigger county cannot, and it is in Section 3. Thank you.
And of course, as the lady, as chair, will remind, this is the initial bill from this body, and the chair anticipates us being back in session later on this month to meet some of those larger needs as well. Representative John, gentleman's recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This question is either for the bill sponsors or staff, as the case may be. First
yes,
of all,
sir.
I, like everyone else, commend all the work that's been done to this point and the subject matter areas that have been addressed. One subject matter area I may have missed was the issue of postal facilities and mailing and mail delivery deadlines dealing with elections. And I don't see that being amended or addressed in any way. And I wondered what consideration had been given to that and why it had not been addressed.
Thank you, Representative John. And Chair, see Representative Mills on the committee. Chair understands has dealt with this issue. As Chair of Elections, Representative Mills, the gentleman's recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative John, the language was reviewed and developed with input from several sources, including the State Board of Elections, the Senate staff, House staff, and of course our central staff. The goal, of course, was a simple goal of trying to help those affected by the hurricane to be able to vote, to make voting more accessible and to help the local boards of elections do their jobs in these affected areas. Now it does do a lot of things. It adds a lot of flexibility when it comes to people, such as judges, such as the multipartisan teams and their efforts, and it does a lot of flexibility regarding the process. Now, you asked about the election day itself and when the ballots are due. Of course, we just passed that bill this session, naming that election day is the day that ballots are due. The bill, as I understand it, does not change the when the ballots are due, but it does do a great deal to help those people in those areas and those boards of elections modify, change, adjust everything from the polls to the polling places. They can modify their early voting plans. They can change the polling place, even across county line in some instances. We've done a lot in the bill. My understanding is that everyone who's worked on it agrees with the language we have in this bill. It does mirror the board's resolution passed earlier in a lot of different ways, in that way as well, because the resolution didn't address that as well. So I commend it to you. There might be some more things we need to look at as things go on, but this bill does a great job in helping the local people reach the goal of helping those people who want to vote be able to do so.
Members, is there further discussion or debate from the committee? Seeing none, Representative Corbett moves for a strike that, actually. Representative Corbett moves to recommend adoption of the conference report to House Bill 149. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Ayes have it, and the conference report receives a favorable report. Members, that's it for today. This committee, we'll have session at 2:15. Committee is now adjourned.
With this idea, getting back to normal, which is about voting. So with all due respect, Chairman Hall, I would urge everyone else in the body for this to vote yes on this resolution on the bill.
For the purpose of the lady from Durham, Representative Morey, rise.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Is it appropriate to be able to speak on the motion?
It is debatable. The chair would just ask members to try to limit time, but we'll take it.
That's fine. Thank you. And I just want to agree, I'm a co-sponsor on this bill, the urgency of it. We can't wait if we have a one-day session. If we wait until October 24th or 5th, when we come back, time is gone. This motion, this bill is of the essence. Early voting registration stops Friday. This simply says, let it go until the day before early voting. People, especially in the West, have no way to access some of the polling places, get their registration done. This gives them an extra 4 or 5 days. It's very simple. And for mail-in ballots from only affected counties, it gives them the grace period of 3 days because of the mail, because of the destruction, to get their ballots in. If we had another day session, we wouldn't be asking to waive the rules. But this is such time of the essence. This is nonpartisan. It is for every possible voter to be able to exercise that. We know this is an extremely close state. We are a battleground state. We want to encourage and give everyone their access to vote. Please vote to allow the motion to suspend the rules so we can hear this bill. Thank you.
Question for the House, is the motion by Representative Rudow to suspend the rules. The vote requires a two-thirds vote. Those in favor of the motion will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. The clerk will open the vote. Representative Austin, Representative Blackwell, Representative Willis, Representative Howard, members wish to record. Clerk will lock the machine, record the vote. 44 having voted in the affirmative and 68 in the negative. The motion is not adopted. We are now on to House Bill 149. The clerk will let me do a few recognitions before we take that up. We do have a number of special recognitions. First of all, on motion of Representative Fontenot of Wilson County, the chair is happy to extend the courtesies of the gallery to Dr. Roosevelt Etheridge and Amir Etheridge of Wilson County. Both are veterans And also visiting is Glenn Osborne, recipient of the Longleaf Pine. Would y'all please stand so we could welcome you today to session. Back over here on the left. Thanks for being with us today. On motion of the gentleman from Lee, Representative Sauls, the chair is happy to extend the courtesies of the gallery to County Commissioner Taylor Vorbeck. Ms. Vorbeck, would you please stand so we could welcome you as well? Back here and about. Good to see you. Also, today we have an honorary page serving with us, Douglas Balcom, who is the honorary page and also the son of Representative Balcom. Douglas, thank you for being here with us today. Also, on motion of the gentleman from Beaufort, Representative Kidwell, the chair is happy to extend the courtesies of the gallery to Paul Varco, who is the vice chair of the Beaufort County Republican Party. Mr. Varco, would you please stand so we could welcome you back here on the left? On motion of the gentleman from Mecklenburg, Representative Alford, chair is happy to extend the courtesies of the gallery to Ms. Aisha Dew, who is a candidate for the House District 107. Which is the encompasses areas formerly represented by Representative Alexander. And we've on the floor unopposed in the general election. Ms. Dew, where are you so we could welcome you as well? She may have left. All right. Well, sounds like she'll be back sometime soon. So also, I see Representative Susan Fisher in the back, who I spoke to earlier. Representative Fisher, good to have you here with us as well. And then also Representative Arthur Williams is here, I believe, over here to my right. So Representative Williams is here, too. So good to see you all. Representative Carney, those are two members of our freshman class 20-some-odd years ago. So they're doing quite fine. They seem to be smiling a little more, not being members now, I see. Members, on motion of the gentleman from Anson, Representative Brody, the chair is able to extend the courtesies of the gallery to Miss Lily Randall, who was crowned Miss North Carolina Elementary America in January and Miss Kindergarten Elementary America in June. Lily is accompanied today by her mother, Carmen Randall. Would y'all please stand so we could welcome you? Thanks for being with us today. We want to welcome those special guests, of course, and our other guests who are here with us today. So now with that, House Bill 149, the clerk will read.
House Bill 149, Conference Committee Report Number 2. A bill to be entitled Disaster Recovery Act of 2024, the General Assembly of North Carolina enacts.
The lady from Henderson, Representative Balcom, is first of all recognized for a motion. Lady wish to move the adoption of the conference report?
Please, sir.
Lady is recognized to move the adoption of the conference report. The motion is before the body, and the lady has the floor to debate the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is just the beginning. This is just the beginning for Western North Carolina. This bill is just an immediate response to set up the necessary infrastructure for effective and long-term recovery efforts for Western North Carolina. It provides state agencies, all of them, with flexibility that they need to help restore normalcy back to Western North Carolina and these hard-hit areas while addressing both immediate and future needs. We have worked hand-in-hand with many of these state agencies to compose this legislation. We want to ensure it meets the immediate challenges we are facing while laying groundwork for the resilience and recovery in the future. I would be crazy not to take this opportunity to thank all of the people across North Carolina, across the United States, who have been in Western North Carolina, giving of their time, giving of their pocketbooks, giving of the needs to everyone in my community. And I want to thank everyone who has come, who's volunteered, who's sent, who's called for doing that. And we appreciate you. The lack of communication in the beginning was scary, but we're going to get better. We are strong people in the mountains. We are going to rebuild. We will be better and bigger and stronger than ever before. This has just been a knockdown, but we are willing to get back up in Western North Carolina. This is just the start. So I would love for you to approve this. I'm going to, if it's okay with you, Mr. Speaker, to yield to Representative Dudley Green.
The gentleman from McDowell, Representative Green, is recognized to debate the conference report.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As everyone here in this body, I assume, knows, September the 27th, Friday morning of 2024, Hurricane Helene ripped through the western part of North Carolina and changed that region as we knew it. Communications, power, water, sewer, gasoline supply, grocery, daily supplies were entirely disrupted. Dozens of fatalities. Still currently hundreds missing and unaccounted for. And we hope that they're okay, but efforts are ongoing to try to locate and determine about that. Entire communities leveled. Damage that we've never witnessed before in that part of the state. Let me echo what Representative Balcom has just said about the response from local agencies and state agencies working together to try to respond to the needs, to see to the safety of people in the area first and foremost, try to restore as many services as they could. There's still, I was talking with one of the representatives from electric co-ops in that area. There's still some 18,000 people, I think, without power as of today. But so many, you know, the response from local officials, local agencies, the response from coordination with the state agencies has just been tremendous. And we're thankful for that up in our neck of the woods. And so many from not only our state, but throughout the United States have offered up their time, talent, and treasure to work towards stabilizing. And that's all that we're working towards, that we've had an opportunity to work towards at this point in time, is to stabilize there so that we can begin some recovery efforts. But so many people, and let me just echo what she said about how appreciative we are. But this is, as she said, only the beginning. We have been fortunate so far in that neck of the woods. We've had some pretty good weather since that occurred. As time goes on, it was down in the 40s this morning. It's going to be into the 30s next week. I was looking at the next week's forecast. So we know cold weather's coming. We know there's going to be continued needs. We still have many displaced and in shelters. And it's going to be a hard winter. I'm just going to be honest with you. But this bill, and as she said, and I appreciate the commitment of this body in that this is not, we know it's not a magic wand, but it is the beginning to lay a framework so that that area of the state can start to recover. It allocates some $273 million from the Rainy Day Fund for hurricane recovery for the most urgent of needs, some $250 million of that to state agencies and local government for federal disaster program matching portions as that starts to filter in, hopefully. Some $16 million for lost compensation for school nutrition programs, some $50 million from the existing water and sewer reserves, $2 million to provide technical assistance for FEMA grants for affected counties. And that's going to be so important because so many of these areas are small towns. They don't have, they're not grant writing experts, and they don't have the availability to that. So that's going to be an important thing. Certain DMV fees waived, giving schools some calendar and funds flexibility to be able to do some things as they need in these unprecedented times. And there are certain environmental requirements that are waived, such as burning restrictions, waste and water restrictions, and road construction restrictions to hopefully help speed the process along in recovery. So, my friends, I appreciate this body and this state's response to this. And again, let me stress, and I don't think anybody here pretends to represent that this will be a magic wand that we can wave and make it all better. But it is hopefully something to put in place, a framework to start to rebuild. Hopefully soon we'll get the bleeding stopped and the healing can start. And this is going to be an important step in that direction. So I ask for your support of this conference report.
For our purpose, the gentleman from Buncombe, Representative Rudell Rice,
to speak on the conference report.
The gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. There have been a few moments in my life when I've been able to see people live up to the best versions of themselves, to step up to a tremendous challenge, to, regardless of the odds, run into danger to save a neighbor. And that is what I saw so many times over the past 12 days. I saw neighbors helping neighbors. I saw first responders perform acts of heroism that were just incredible. I saw communities come together. I saw people drive from all over this country and all over the world to come and help us, come to our aid. I saw the full extent of our state and federal government come to our rescue. I'm extremely grateful to this body. I'm grateful to all our first responders, and I'm grateful to everybody for their help for Western North Carolina. I think you all have seen the pictures at this point. You might have seen more pictures than I have. We haven't had power or water in 12 days, and we're one of the lucky ones. But the pictures don't do it justice. They don't show the terrifying power of this storm. I was in Asheville for the last 100-year storm in 2004. And I'll tell you, it was awful, but it bore absolutely no resemblance to the terrifying destruction that we have just seen. Our storms are now being supercharged, and they bring havoc, and that's because of climate change, and they are terribly destructive. Y'all have seen the pictures, but they truly don't do it justice. The floodwaters rose about 25 feet above normal level in some places. Because I think it's important for this body to understand what that means, I measured out 25 feet. And if you look right up there to the top of those blinds, that is 25 feet high. And you imagine that power in a river moving downstream, and that is a pressure washer that washes away houses, that blows houses into bridges and takes out the bridges, that destroys people's lives. Again, I am so grateful for the work of Chairman Hall and Speaker Moore and everybody who worked on this bill. I truly think it's a great bill. But it's going to require more work. As Representative Balcom and Representative Green said, this is the start, and we have so much work to do. And I think a part of that has to be acknowledging climate change and doing something about it. So it's going to require us to all work together. And so I hope we continue this effort of working together and bipartisanship and tackle this problem, because I am frankly terrified that another storm will hit. And I see the storm in Florida, and I had PTSD this morning, because knowing the destruction that brings is truly terrifying. And so I urge everybody to vote yes on this bill. I thank the body for its support, and thank you for allowing me to speak.
What purpose does the gentleman from Forsyth, Representative Lambeth, rise?
Speak on the bill.
Gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker and colleagues, I was very fortunate last Friday to go up by helicopter with Kyle Hall and Commissioner Troxler. And it's all been said, and I can't really add to that, but I did want to share a story with you. As we landed in Avery County and we went over to the little town of Spruce Pine, and we met with retail owners who had shops that were full of mud and the water lines up to the second floor of those buildings. They've lost everything. The attitude they had was unbelievably positive. Of all the volunteers, of all the food and water and things that were coming up there, the mechanical thing, everything that they could imagine was coming into their county to help them out. And while I was there and we were talking to this couple who owned a coffee shop that, I mean, really, she was very proud of it. She talked about how much money she invested and how busy it was, but it was gone. And she was sweeping out 6 inches of mud in the store that she was in. She smiled the whole time. She hugged us. She was friendly. She was so positive. Well, I looked outside her store and I saw a rubble of stuffed animals, Christmas ornaments, a variety of things that she had just pushed out and other workers had pushed out from her store. Everything was gone. And I saw a heart that was laying in the rubble. And I walked over to it. It was red. And the heart in the rubble, I asked her, could I take that back to Raleigh? And she said, by all means. And I have a message. Tell the people that we love them, but we need their help. This little ornament was in her store and had been pushed out in the rubble. And on one side, it says, love. We love North Carolina. We love the people. We love our community. And we want to rebuild, but we need your help. I am so positive that this bill was a start to the help they need. So thank you for supporting this. I hope it is unanimous because we need to get on with the work of fixing the lives of these people that have a broken life right now.
What purpose does the lady from Forsyth, Representative Baker, rise?
To ask the bill sponsor a question.
Is that to Representative Baucom or to Representative Green?
Either one, sir.
Whichever member would like to take the question. Representative Baucom yields.
Thank you. I just had a allocation question for the additional remote instruction in Section 81B on page 5. I did not see any additional money allocated to cover the remote learning, so I was just wondering if that was somewhere else, because we're talking about the need for additional technology. How will we ensure that remote learning can take place when we still don't have network services there? So I was just wondering if there was any additional money somewhere else in the bill, which I didn't see, that would allow for us to distribute additional technology to cover remote learning.
I may have to defer to staff on some of this.
Okay. If like, what we'll do is if the lady will just consult with staff, then
okay.
We get an answer either on the floor or if she gets you the answer
that's
directly.
Fine.
Is that fine?
Yes.
Okay. Thank There's you. Central staff back there. So.
Thank you.
Right. Absolutely. What purpose does the gentleman from Union, Representative R. Price?
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to speak on the bill.
Gentleman has the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, of course, I would like to urge you to speak to vote for this measure. But I also want to take the opportunity as one who works in the public utilities to reflect on the tremendous effort that has been seen across North Carolina. I'm a man of faith and belief. But I have to admit, sometimes I don't understand why bad things happen. Over 200 people have lost their lives. People have lost their homes, businesses, lives forever changed. I don't understand that sometimes. But in my walk with the Lord, I've come to know, believe, and trust in His sovereignty. And time again, I've seen goodness come out of the most tragic and hard times. And what I've seen in this tragedy here, that people have helped their neighbors that have come out. And I want to thank the men and women of the utilities, the electric co-ops, the National Guard. Time and time again, we've heard stories of where this husband and wife team both work for Duke Power. Let their children go stay with their grandparents so that they can both work in the storm. The Baptist Men on Mission provided showers and food and clothing for these workers. And these workers worked tirelessly to get the power back on. As of now, we've got 63,000 still without power, where over 1.4 million have been restored. No effort will stop until all the power's back on and the healing begins. The electric co-ops have seen people come in. There's probably about 18,000 still without power, but we've seen the co-ops pull together. And this is symbolic of the very community in which they serve, where they come and pull themselves together. The National Guard was involved in sending in relief and so many times. And I just want to have a shout out to them, because our neighbors, our family, our friends were all affected by this. But the best of North Carolina showed up and will continue to show up. And while the rescue is over, the recovery is going to begin. And to speak to the question about funding, as we understand in the appropriation, more issues and more targeted amounts are going to be given to us. We're going to come back and have additional help and support. Right now, this is the first step in getting immediate setup to receive all of this. The additional remote learning dollars and support will happen once we figure out what to do with the schedule and so forth. And so these are the things that are happening. But with that, I want to say thank you to all of those North Carolinians who've worked in our utilities and our guard who sacrificed to help fellow North Carolinians.
For what purpose does the lady from Guilford, Representative Harrison, rise?
To briefly debate the bill.
Lady has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And ladies and gentlemen of the House, I don't want to repeat all that's been said, but I echo the sentiment that's been expressed about the incredible devastation that's affected Western North Carolina and how the citizens, our state agencies, first responders, leadership have responded and pitched in. I just don't think it can go without talking about a really important piece of this bill, which is the elections piece. Because it's a big portion of it. And I just want to thank the leadership. I want to thank the State Board of Elections. I understand they and the county boards have been working hard. This storm had the potential to really interfere with the elections administration in those 25 Western counties. But it looks like the State Board came up with unanimous recommendations that will address many of the concerns. And this legislation basically blesses all of those recommendations and adds $5 million in appropriations to those affected counties. So I just wanted to thank everybody who was involved in that, because that's a really important piece of this bipartisan bill. Thanks.
Thank you. What purpose does the gentleman from Chatham, Representative Reeves, rise?
To speak on the bill. The
gentleman has the floor.
And again, not going to repeat, and I know we're ready to go ahead and vote on this. I just want to say, just not just for us, but folks that are listening in, it's been an incredible response from everybody. We've all got people who have been affected. All of us have family, friends, obviously friends that are in here that have been affected out west. And this has taken a full response from everybody. And I thank the members of this body, thank the members of the State Senate. I thank the members of our U.S. Senate who have been down. I thank the members of our congressional delegation who have all been out. I appreciate the work of the governor, the president, and everybody that has come together. I would reiterate what was talked about to start this out, that this is not a partisan issue. When people lose their lives, when people need their government, they need their full government. And on days like this, we don't represent parts of this state. We represent this whole state, each of us, because our folks need us. And so please keep that in mind going forward. Keep people in your prayers. Keep the first responders in your prayers. Keep these volunteers in your prayers. The most heartening thing that I have found is all of the people who have gone out who weren't necessarily always trained in doing this or most experienced in doing this, but went straight out west as soon as this happened. There were countless law enforcement officers and everybody else coming from all over the state to go out there, but it's been a really good joint response. And I think I got it mainly to speak on behalf of those first responders, because that's one of the things that they've appreciated, is that we've kept this nonpartisan and want us to keep this nonpartisan, because they need every inch of help they can get. So thank you for this. Thank you for this bill and the work we've done. And we look forward to all of us working together on what comes next on October 24th and what continues to go on with this circumstance. So thank you.
Further discussion, further debate? If not, the question for the House is the adoption of the conference report to House Bill 149. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. The clerk will open the vote. Balcom, aye. Johnson of Polk, aye. Representative Austin on the floor. Does she need to be excused?
Yes, please. She has a doctor's appointment.
Okay. Please go ahead and show Representative Austin's excuse, Mr. Clerk. Clerk will lock the machine and record the vote. 113 having voted in the affirmative and none of the negative. House Bill 149's conference report is adopted, and the Senate will be so notified. Senate Bill 445 and House Bill 10 will be at this time calendared for October 24th. We'll advise members if it'll be taken up, but that they're going to at least be moved to that calendar off of today's calendar. Remember, we are awaiting the revised adjournment resolution from the Senate that I believe chairs notified the members earlier that will bring us back in on October 24th. Just a couple of things. Some of the staff are leaving right now. Just before you guys get too far gone, just a couple of things chair would like to point out. First off, really do thank our central staff, our clerk's office, all the folks who pitched in with our staff in the corner office, and just a number of folks to try to work together to put this legislation together on a really, really tight time crunch. I want to thank those staff members for their work. Thank you for the hours y'all put in. We appreciate it. It's going to make a difference. Also, just as a point of personal privilege of the chair, had the opportunity to visit all of the counties in the affected area, I believe except for one, and over the last week or so, and it kind of became a blur after a point, but met with a number of folks here that are here, a number of members. Of course, I had the chance to go spend some time with Representative Green up there and see what he's dealing with, not only personally, but how he's done so much to help his community. Representative Baucom, who's done the same, spent some good time with Representative Prather and Representative Ager. We saw just absolutely unbelievable things in Buncombe County, and I don't have words. Representative Blackwell, of course, we had some time to spend in Burke County, to Burke and McDowell, to see that. Representative Pickett, who we spent some time together, he came over and helped as well with what Representative Green was working on. Representative Jake Johnson, of course, we split Rutherford County, and you all seen the pictures of Chimney Rock and Lake Ward. Representative Pless, who was actually out literally rescuing people as part of his second job. I'm told he had some sort of diving suit. I'm glad he didn't wear that today. But was literally out in a rubber raft rescuing people from vehicles. And then we even had a couple senators that we met up with, Senator Moffitt and Senator Heiss, and got to see Senator Heiss 8 days without a shower. He looked a little different today than the last time I saw him. But just so much that these members who are there, and of course, there are other members of live in the affected area that I didn't get to, but seeing these folks who are there, every one of them, every one that I mentioned, not just none of them are worried about themselves, even though they've all had certain loss and that they've dealt with, but every one of them giving back to their community, what it is they, you know, asking what it is that they can do to give back. And I appreciate those members' hospitality and efforts at those times. And we'll just point out that it is you go around, and I don't know how many of you have made it up there. I know, of course, I know Representative Winslow, Representative Zinger took some heavy equipment up there and worked and did a lot. And it's the problem when you start mentioning things, you know you're going to forget somebody. I know Representative Clampett was out working hard, trying to get the word out on the radio. And, of course, Representative Gillespie was over helping as well in his area. And Representative Riddell, I know we didn't get a chance to connect. You were tied up, I believe, in other meetings at that time, and we couldn't. But I know you were helping your community as well. But my point in saying that is that those who were not in the area should be very proud of your colleagues who are there, who every single one of them, without exception, are stepping up to help their friends, their neighbors, their family, and doing so during the most trying times. And I think it's an example of what makes this state and this country great. And I just, on behalf of everyone, on behalf of your colleagues, thank you all for what you've done. We know that there's going to be more that we have to do in October, more that we have to do in November. And frankly, I suspect as we roll into next year, this is going to be something that those of you who are going to be back next year are going to be working on as well, and probably for a couple of years to come, because the amount of work that's going to be needed is massive. But the good thing is no one's just sitting around saying, what do we do? There are plans being developed right now. There's action being taken. You know, roads are being restored. Debris being removed. Of course, there's still a search for victims and others that haven't been located. But the rebuilding phase is not just being talked about. It's moving forward. The legislation that you all just voted for is legislation that will allow us to move forward more nimbly, that will allow the state to do what it can to respond. I do also want to say a special shout out to Representative Reeves. I appreciate you mentioning the first responders who've been out there. These folks in these local communities who themselves have suffered probably great loss, who are there giving back to take care of their communities. The volunteers who have shown up from near and far to help. Of course, our hardworking local and state government employees who have really put in the time. But it's really been an amazing thing where it's pitched in. You probably heard the stories of folks who donated to their own expense, you know, the air assets. And I know that, Representative Adams, Representative Setzer were helpful in those folks that were being based out of Hickory. There's so many stories. There's a lot of sad stories, obviously, and there's a lot. There's going to be a big challenge ahead that both the state and the federal level is going to need to step up to do, to take care of so many who were hurting, who have suffered so much damages. But I know we can get it done. I know we will get it done. And there are those who are even right now, as we're in here with some nice air conditioning and everybody probably had hot showers and all that, who still don't have those things, who still don't have electricity, who still don't have water. I guess they're saying, a couple months still for water in Asheville right now. But there are efforts happening. There's emergency water treatment systems being brought into some of these towns. And, you know, the smaller towns, they can do that where they can treat the water, they can treat the wastewater. And it's really been encouraging to see the collaboration that's happening to try to move things forward. And so I say that this is our part we do as a General Assembly as a first step, but it's not by any means the last step. It'll be step one of many steps to come. And we're just very fortunate that the state treasury is in a good position to be able to handle something like this. What I would ask, and we are still waiting on the adjournment resolution from the Senate, but I do think it would be appropriate this time to take a moment of silence of those who have perished and lost their lives during Hurricane Helene. And if the body doesn't mind, I would ask you to join me for a moment of silence on that. Thank you. So our next step will be to continue forward doing this work. Would also extend an invitation to, of course, the members from the West, but anyone who wants to be involved and engaged in next steps and what we have going forward, make sure to contact, of course, any of my staff. Make sure to talk to the appropriations chairs about ideas, proposals. Make sure we have those things in the queue. We know that there are still things that were in this particular bill we passed today, ideas that came in late, but it just we had to deal with what we could take care of at this time. But we can get those done. And again, we'll be right back here on the 24th. But make sure to start working on those suggestions and work with central staff, who will be glad to formulate those ideas into something that can be executed as policy, most likely. So with that, while we're awaiting, I don't think we have, are we in possession of that, Mr. Clerk? Oh, well, we are. Messages from the Senate, the clerk will read.
Special message from the Senate, October 9, 2024. Mr. Speaker, it is ordered that a message be sent to the House of Representatives with the information that the Senate adopts the report of the conferees for House Bill 149, Conference Committee Substitute, a bill to be enacted, an act to enact the Disaster Recovery Act of 2024. When the appropriate action has been taken by both chambers, the bill will be ordered and rolled. Respectfully, Sarah Holland, Principal Clerk.
Noted, and the bill is ordered, enrolled, and sent to the governor by special messenger. And I did almost forget to give Representative Jones a shout out. He was with us during part of that visit as well. So appreciate your leaning in on the transportation side of things as well. Without objection, we've gotten another message from the Senate. If the clerk would read that, please. I believe that's the adjournment resolution or modified adjournment resolution. Clerk may read.
The following special message is received from the Senate. Senate Joint Resolution 919, First Edition, a joint resolution adjourning the session, reconvened pursuant to Resolution 2024-2 and amending Resolution 2024-2. The Senate resolves, the House concurring.
Without objection, Chair would ask that bill be added to today's calendar. And so ordered. And the clerk will read the bill.
Senator Rabin, Senate Joint Resolution 919, a joint resolution adjourning the session, reconvening pursuant to Resolution 2024-2 and amending Resolution 2024-2. The Senate resolves, the House concurring.
Rules Chairman, Representative Hall of Caldwell is recognized to debate the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members, as you've already heard, this adjourns us until October 24th. I ask for your support.
Further discussion, debate on the motion on the second reading. If not, question before the House, passage of Senate Joint Resolution 919. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. The clerk will open the vote. Pickett, aye. Representative Lowry on the floor. Chair saw him a second ago. Okay, Representative Morey, wish to vote? Please show Lowry excused. He had to leave. Clerk Lot Machine record the vote. 110 having voted in the affirmative and 3 in the negative. Senate Joint Resolution 919 passed the second reading without objection. Here we have third time.
The Senate resolves, the House concurring.
Question for the House, passage of Senate Joint Resolution 919 on third reading. Those in favor will say aye. Those opposed, no. As have it, Senate Joint Resolution 919, having passed its third reading, it's ordered and rolled. Members, we will now go to notices and announcements. For what purpose, the lady from Mecklenburg, Representative Bud Rice.
Yes, I want to remind everybody who has not stopped at 101 North Wilmington Street to please come by and either donate the needed supplies or make a donation to the Disaster Relief Fund for the victims in Western North Carolina. We've seen a number of you out there today, And I already say thank you, as does Representative Crutchfield. This is probably the last act, unless we do one on the 24th, for the bipartisan donation drive. If you have ideas, let us know. If you didn't get a chance to donate today and want to, please reach out to myself or Representative Crutchfield, and we will let you know where to send those. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, and thank you. For what purpose does the lady from Wake, Representative Dahl, rise?
Inquiry of the chair.
Please recognize.
Do you have any guesstimate of what time on the 24th we will come back?
So we come back at noon. It might be a similar schedule as today, where we have to, because we routinely would have a committee and then come back in the afternoon, but noon's when we reconvene. For what purpose does the gentleman from Buncombe, Representative Vega, rise?
Point of personal privilege.
The gentleman has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just want to thank everybody who's reached out over the last couple of days. I don't think it's been 2 weeks yet, but it seems like a lot longer. And just to reiterate the great words of Representative Balcom, Green, Rudow, Lambeth, Arp, and Speaker Moore, you know, I think it's really important that we remember what the story of this is. You know, there's a lot of narratives floating around, and I just want to remind us all that this is a story of mountain resilience, as you all have said. It's a story of the community coming together, neighbors helping neighbors. It's a story of fire departments and EMS personnel literally saving lives for long periods of time. It's a story of government at all levels coming together to work together, figure it out in a disaster that nobody anticipated. It's a story of city workers who didn't sleep for weeks, and county workers who killed themselves to really get the job done for the people of North Carolina. It's a story of churches who set up and organized and distributed food, brought it in. It's a story of our neighbors from around the country who drove in supplies and flew helicopters and brought things in. It's a story of our state National Guard, our military, who were there to help us when we needed it. And, you know, it's also a story about people like our Black Mountain Fire Chief, John Coffey, and the town manager. It's a story about our Swannanoa Fire Chief, Anthony Penland, who many of you know. It's a story about these people who got very little sleep for a long time in really difficult circumstances with fire stations that were flooded out, and no playbook or communication with the outside world in a lot of cases. You know, it's a story about people like Wade Wright, who's the fire chief up in Garen Creek, or what we call Craigtown, sort of in between Fairview and Black Mountain, who's been leading the rescue effort. He's there today, I guarantee it, from his community from day one, despite losing family members in the mudslide right across the street from the fire station. And it's a story about, you know, people like my classmate, Tony Garrison, who died trying to pull out the wife of another, you know, the second baseman on my little league team, you know, in up in Garen Creek, trying to pull him out, and he saved a human life and then paid for it with his own. And so I want to make sure that this is the story that we tell. It's about people coming together. It's about everybody working to help each other out. And so thank you all very much for that.
Yes, sir. Thank you. What purpose, lady from Buncombe, Representative Prather, rise.
A point of personal privilege.
Lady has the floor.
Thank you. Very similar to Eric. I want to say thank you. Thank you for passing this needed legislation. These funds are absolutely a good start. This has been really hard for all of us, but I have also been astounded and humbled by the coordination between our levels of government. Just this morning, my delegation and I spoke with the governor, FEMA, DHHS, and the Army to get updates on their efforts. I've spoken directly with thousands of my constituents. I've delivered supplies, visited churches, all of us have. I spent half a day in the car with our county emergency management director, Taylor Jones, reviewing the damage. I spent a few hours yesterday morning with one of our local fire chiefs, Shane Presswood, traveling around the western part of my district, checking on folks and him pointing out everything that's already been accomplished. The personal connections that I and my delegation and our local folks have to the community are being leveraged to make sure that resources are getting where they need to go. This is personal. I know y'all know that. Western North Carolina is a special place, unlike any other. The people are creative and caring and resourceful and resilient. The mountains are homey and lush and life-giving. Each little community has its own character and style, but we are all mountain folk. Our local radio stations have stepped up in a serious way to provide news, as well as some musical levity to the community. Restaurants immediately started giving away what they could to people in need. Neighbors checked on neighbors before officials could even access the roads. But they can't do it on their own. This is going to take a lot of work. We need to show folks that the government has their back right now at the time they need it most. Not just in my district, in all of Western North Carolina. The vacation land that people watched get ravaged on TV, it's a permanent home to many, many people. Please don't forget us.
Yes, ma'am. Well, Representative Goodwin is recognized, sent forth a representative statement, which will be read in its entirety upon adjournment today and spread across the journal. The lady from Waite, Representative Cervania, is recognized to send forth a representative statement as well that will be read in its entirety upon adjournment and spread across the journal as well. And the lady has the floor to speak to a point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just want to briefly say our thoughts and prayers are with the people in Western North Carolina. And I want to briefly actually say thank you for the Civil Air Patrol who's been working 24/7 trying to find people who are missing, and NCDOT who actually provided them free parking from now into the future to help support them. But I am going to speak for two statements that I've submitted. One of which is first is to recognize Hispanic Heritage Month, and it's with great pleasure to do this, and I don't want to take a lot of time considering the sensitivity of what's happening today, but and also for honoring the Filipino American History Month. There's about 10% of Western North Carolina that are of Hispanic and Filipino descent, so just to recognize how they've shaped and strengthened and have contributed to the community in terms of who, how they built, and also trying to help in the recovery process as well. And I'm just gonna leave it at that considering. So with all the people in Western North Carolina and also honoring all those, thank you very much for this time. And let's make sure we remember how we came here and then how we go forward. Thank you.
Thank you. And I believe there are a number of guests in the gallery to be recognized on motion of Representative Cervania, Waite County. I believe we have Diego Barahona, Claudia Rivera, Walter Gomez, Adrian Maldonado, Anna Rios, Anna Reza Versola, and a number of team members from El Centro Hispano. Would y'all please stand so we could welcome you all if you're here, up here on the left. Thanks for being with us today. What purpose does the lady from Mecklenburg, Representative Logan Rice?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. A moment of personal privilege.
Lady has four.
I'll just thank the body for the report today to help the people of Western North Carolina. As most of you know, Asheville is my home. And I went up there this past weekend. One of my former colleagues trusted me to borrow his truck. I mean, who would do that? And my sister rented a truck out of Atlanta where she lives. And we took a lot of supplies up to my family. I still have family in Asheville. And we took some to some friends up there also. And when a former Representative Fisher, when we saw each other last night, of course, our eyes met because, you know, I'm homegirl. And we talked about Asheville. Asheville is where I started my law enforcement career, Asheville Police Department. The parts of Asheville that's been destroyed are the parts of Asheville that I patrolled. And I rode through the river district where I used to patrol at night, pull in behind the warehouses, catch a nap sometimes. Got a little tired. It was real scary back there, so I couldn't close my eyes. My father, as I always told my father and my brother, who were both with the railroad, there was a roundhouse back there off the river road. And I know when I was little, riding along the mighty French Broad, I was always watched that river and worried about that river coming out, even when I was patrolling at night, worried about the mighty French Broad River. If I would, you know, get too close to the edge or the mighty French Broad will come out. And even back then in those days, sometimes it would. But I never seen anything like I saw. Norfolk Southern's buildings down there, the tracks are flooded. The river district is flooded. I stood on top of the West Asheville Bridge where I stood so many times to direct traffic and just looked over. And I was telling my niece what the ice house was where my father used to take me to the ice house to pick ice up on Sundays. And I took around another way and I saw a lot of police cars from different parts of the state. And I said, this must be where they're staying. And I said, there used to be a Chesterfield Mills back here. And I said, watch this, when we turn the corner, there's gonna be more railroad tracks. And of course they were closed off because there was so much mud back there. And we went another way, you couldn't go through, you could go two way directions because there was so much mud, you could only travel one way. And then I went to Biltmore, where I was raised only 5 miles from the entrance to the Biltmore Estates. And she and I looked at each other and we both cried because the carriage house was gone. The McDonald's looked like someone set off a bomb inside of it. And Sweeten Creek Road, the mighty Swan of Noise, where it came out amid the French Broad and has just destroyed Biltmore. And Asheville is known for Biltmore because that's America's castle, sits there in the Biltmore Estates. Then we rode by the Rue Chris and they were moving it out when my dead brother used to take us and they knew him by name. Asheville is destroyed, my home. And although I'm proud of Charlotte and I love Charlotte and I told somebody, Disney started with a mouse, but I started with Asheville. And we're gonna have to help those people because everybody said, I wonder why is the help going to Asheville? Asheville is our seventh largest city. And everything is there. They have recreational things. They have a Western State Fair, what I worked so many years. And I was there in 2004 when Asheville flooded at the Western Fair. And I helped people get down I-26 and through the Biltmore's area again because we couldn't start the fair. So we have to make sure that our heart, if you're showing a heart, make sure your heart is in the right place. And those people need us. We are North Carolina. We are the government. We are who they're looking to, and we need to help them. And yes, our law enforcement were out there, and they're doing the best they can. They're everywhere. I even saw NYPD in Chimney Rock. So they're coming from everywhere to help the great state of North Carolina. Let us help the great state of North Carolina. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Any further notices or announcements? Seeing nothing further before the body, the gentleman from Caldwell, Representative Hall, is recognized for motion.
Mr. Speaker, pursuant to Senate Joint Resolution 919 and subject to the standard stipulation set forth in Rule 15.1, I move the House do now adjourn to reconvene Thursday, October 24th at 12 noon.
Representative Hall moves, seconded by Representative Dudley Green, that pursuant to Senate Joint Resolution 919 and subject to the standard stipulation set forth in Rule 15.1, the House do now adjourn to reconvene Thursday, October 24th at 12 noon. Those in favor will say aye. Those opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the House stands adjourned.
There you have it. That's what officials had to say today at the NCGA. You heard them pass the legislation, so, and it has been sent to the governor. Just an update, Representative Jake Johnson posted on social media, quote, unanimous vote in both chambers for the first round of funding to Western North Carolina. This bill includes $273 million in funding and legislation to expedite recovery efforts. And it was passed 113-0. More to come. Please subscribe and support my work. And with Cops in Congress, AnnieDance.substack.com. I greatly appreciate your support. See you next time.